Ready, New York?
All right, let's get it started.
You have your roll call.
Roll call.
Call the main order, roll call.
Mr. Salcido?
Here.
Mrs. Hawkins?
Here.
Mrs. Dolezal?
Here.
Mr. Wright?
Here.
And Mr. Mitchell?
Hi, here.
Okay, I'm wearing the suit and tie tonight, typically don't, but I'm wearing the suit and tie tonight because we are filming this for the website. We have engineered our handy dandy tripod technology apparatus over here, and we're working on the process of our board meetings of filming them, and ultimately we're looking at doing what the city is going to be doing and streaming them live. Okay, we have that capability now to do that. And we might need to add a few microphones in the room hither, there, and yonder, because these may not pick up everything we need to pick up. But we're working on that. So this is our trial run. And plus, this is good information to post for the website. Today is also a good day. For those of you in the room who are my Facebook friends, today is my 20th wedding anniversary. So I'm pretty excited about that. Yes, that's good. Thank you. But more importantly, it is also National Pancake Day, and you can pick up free pancakes at IHOP. So, you know, everyone's got to have their priorities.
That's where you're going after.
That's where I'm going after this. That's it. I'm taking her to IHOP so we get some free pancakes. That says 20th anniversary all over it. You get whipped cream on that little pancake, too. So there you go. Okay. Thank you, Gina. Just a couple of slides here. Did that any of that work? Maybe? Maybe it's
okay. Just don't turn off the fans.
Yeah, don't you turn off Dave if you turn off the fans. Can you still see it?
Oh, no, that's fine.
Oh, okay, that's fine. Okay. As promised, what we're going to start doing is start talking about the budget. We talked about at the last meeting, some of that carryover type stuff. We have done some presentations on our loss in state aid, or our projected loss in state aid for next year, which was about $2 million. So this is a continuation of that conversation that we have had before. Just like any conversation about numbers in the school business, here are the disclaimers. We're going to try and give you some approximate numbers and approximate figures, and then also as well, we're going to start talking about some construction projects. And granted, there are a lot of random variables that go into this, but we do think that the numbers that we're going to be presenting you tonight are in the ballpark, and they're really good round number estimates. They're not going to be exactly to the penny, but there are at least some good opportunities for us to have some conversations about some finances in our district. All right, a little bit of a review again. We did this at the last meeting. Let's talk about history. Way back in July, I told the school board that we were saving our monies in two areas for two different things. The first one is in something that we call M&O, or our general fund. That's gas bill, water bill, electric bill, payroll. And we were saving our money for two things. Number one is a declining ADM, and then the state's new accounting procedure called saying you're funded. We're also saving money in another fund, which is our other primary fund that we have for the school district, which is capital, and that handles our facilities and maintenance issues that we have in the district. Okay, we have some issues in some of our facilities that are either at pay me now or pay me triple later, and unfortunately we have a lot of things that are at pay me triple later. So anyway, I just want to remind you what we talked about in July, and we are still on that course. The other thing that I presented at the last meeting was some information about student enrollment. And part of the reasons why we're looking at a decrease in funding in state aid. We are estimating that loss right now at about $2 million. I believe that that's probably, at this day and time, a little bit low. I think it might be a little bit more of a loss than $2 million. But for the sake of tonight, we're going to call it $2 million. Okay, any questions on the information that I've already shown you before? Yes? No? Okay. The last slide that I have for you is our goals. These are the financial goals that come from me and come from our financial department, which is Gina and Sharon. and they are in order of importance for our district. The first one is that we have got to maintain financial stability for our school district. When I first came to Casa Grande, the school district had a Standard & Poor bond rating of about a B minus, almost a C. And we had gone and taken out a loan or a bond issue on Vista Grande High School with that very, very poor bond rating. The reasons why that bond rating was there was because of poor financial management and financial instability in the district. We have consequently increased significantly that bond rating, okay? And we went out and refinanced that note on Vista Grande High School about 2 years ago. Everybody remember that? Saved this community or the citizens of Casa Grande Union High School District a little over $1 million in regards to interest payments on what was left on the note at Vista Grande High School. Not only do we have to maintain financial stability for our school district in regards to payroll, gas bill, water bill, electric bill, and making sure that we're getting all of our vendors and our employees paid properly, but we also have to maintain financial stability for that bond rating. If our bond rating falls again, if our bond rating decreases because of poor financial planning or as a result of poor financial stability, what happens is that the interest rates on the note that we have on Vista Grande High School goes up. When that happens, everyone's property taxes is immediately increased to cover the difference. Okay? So that's our number one priority goal, is to maintain the financial stability for this district. The other one is a step raise for all employees. Every employee in this district is valuable. Every employee works to serve the children of this community, and every employee deserves the opportunity for a step raise. Number three is to adequately cover health care for all of our employees. I have said it many times, and I'll say it again. I believe, this is a personal belief, but I believe that it is the responsibility of the employer to take care of the insurance and health care coverage for the employee. I don't know any different, sadly, maybe not sadly, but gladly, that's how I was raised. That is the systems that I have grown up in, and that is the responsibility of a good employee. Number four is to maintain low class sizes within the budget constraints. We got what we got in regards to the money. So we need to try to manage our money as effectively and efficiently as possible so that we can maximize those funds and put those funds into kids and try to keep class sizes as low as we possibly can. Any questions on those priorities? I think they're pretty doggone good ones. And those are the way, this is the way that both Gina, Sharon, and I address the financial needs of the district is in this order. Ladies, anything you want to add to that? Once, twice? No? Okay. All right, let's turn the lights on. Let's talk about some money.
Let's turn this on.
It's been a long time since I've actually taught class, so I'm going to kind of enjoy this. Okay. And sadly, I will tell you, this is how my brain works. So I'm going to apologize for that in advance. Those who are in the back of the room have seen this a million times over, and they know how my brain works, and they can follow along. So if I lose you, by all means, please ask questions, okay? We've seen this graph before at the bottom, okay? This is the fiscal years as they clip along, okay? The arrows, if you remember from our last conversation, this is the carryover as we head into year after year after year after year in order to maintain that financial stability, because we have to have a healthy carryover in the school district in order to maintain the financial integrity and to maintain our Standard & Poor bond rating for the school district, okay? So we're sitting here in the year 2016, and we're going to be carrying some money over. We'll get to all of that stuff in just a second. But what's going to happen next year is a $2 million hole in our budget. Okay, that's going to be a $2 million hole in state aid. Now, if you remember, I told you it's really not going to be just $2 million. I think it's going to be a little higher than that, sadly. But for our talking purposes for today, we're just going to leave it at $2 million. The problem is what's going to happen is that $2 million hole
will maintain in our budget until we deal with it. There are only two methodologies for dealing with losses in state aid revenue. There are only two. Number one, increase the number of kids coming into the district. Pretty simple. That's a revenue approach. All students have little dollar signs that are floating above their heads, which is the state aid calculation that has been granted by the state of Arizona. For some kids who are regular ed kids, they have a smaller dollar sign. For special needs students, they have a larger dollar sign because of a weighted percentage that the state gives them on something called the state aid funding formula. That's a little bit complex, so we won't go there. But in essence, for school districts, for any schools, students equate to revenues. So if you want to deal with a funding issue, it's real simple. Get more kids. The second option for dealing with losses in state aid allocation, that's the bad one that we don't want to talk about a whole lot. That means that we have to cut expenses. That's not fun. That's not fun for administrators, that's not fun for superintendents, that's not fun for staff, and that's not fun for school boards. Yes, Nancy?
But what the tax revenues, I know they've increased now about 2% this year over last year. I don't have the number yet.
Right. And so those things may affect some of this number, okay? But they're not going to impact this number. At some point in time, this school district is going to have to deal with this number.
Will it not help offset it?
No. Not that much. So with that being said, we're either going to have to increase the number of kids or we're going to have to decrease expenses because we cannot, with the amount of monies that we have in carryover, the bottom line is that we cannot maintain the pace.
I have a question for you, just kind of go back to what Nancy asked. Can you give us a little more details on, you said not that much. So if it goes up, the state taxes go up by, or the
revenues go up 2%. They should go even more next year because everything's higher.
Let's just use 2. I mean, so what kind of impact are we looking?
It'll increase the amount of monies that we get from local property taxes slightly, which does increase our bottom line. Is that 2% increase going to offset a $2 million loss in state aid? No. It'll help. It'll help. And every little bit that we get in regards to revenue, whether it's kids, whether it's local property taxes, whether we pass a bond issue, every little thing that we get in regards to revenue helps. But we're going to have to deal with this issue because at some point in time, we are going to be upside down in that car. And that is the worst words that you ever want to hear a superintendent tell you is funding cliff, because it's coming. We cannot sustain the pace of the decrease of revenue and the maintaining of the expenses. We can hold on to it for a while, but at some point in time, we're going to run out of money. So I'm ballpark projecting that funding cliff is going to hit us some point in time in 2018-2019 school year. Now, I don't know when yet. I don't know what month yet, but we're trying to work on narrowing that information down. But at some point in time, we're going to have some problems because ultimately, we're going to run out of money and we can't sustain the pace. Other things that you look at when we start talking about funding cliffs, it doesn't just impact your M&O or your general fund budget, gas bill, water bill, electric bill, payroll. It also impacts your federal funds. Our federal funds are based upon, our allocated numbers are based upon the amount of students that we have in the district. As the numbers of students decrease, so does your federal funding. And federal programs work the same way as your general fund. There's only so much carryover that Mr. Merrill can pull out of subsequent years to offset the losses that you're going to equate in regards to your federal funds. And right now, we're looking at an additional, on top of this, we're looking at an additional $200,000 loss in our federal programs.
Yeah, we mentioned something about our funding that Nancy brought up, but what about inflation? I mean, so are we including the base inflation the current year? I mean, we're going to lose money on inflation.
If you can predict the cost of gasoline, you let me know and we'll go invest in futures.
I guess my question is, are you equating that in this diagram here?
My thing is, I think it's all gonna come out in the wash. Stuff's gonna go up, we're gonna get more out of property taxes. It's gonna cost us more to buy diesel, but we got a little bit extra on property tax, it's all.
And that's where I was going with it, I mean, so.
It all comes out in the wash. I've been doing this now going on 17 years. It all comes, if you increase in one area, then in revenue, then, and then you got expenses to offset it, so. The math that I've shown you is gonna hold true. And I do wanna also stress to you this, which is critically huge for our taxpayers in regards to a bond rating. When you start talking about funding cliffs in 2018, 2019, because we're now upside down, we've got more expenses than what we have revenues, if we have not made some decisions, if we have not been able to fix this problem by either number one, increasing the number of students into the district, or number two, decreasing the expenses, we've got serious problems because we cannot operate on credit. And I want to stress to you again, if our bond rating drops, because we have not made good sound financial decisions as a school district, as a board, our taxpayers pay the difference. And I just don't think that's fair. Other information to think about is in 2018 is our first opportunity to go out for an override vote in November of 2018. So we will have a measure for you in the summer, right before November, to put on the ballot of whether or not we want to go out for another override. I'm always recommending that we do. Currently, our override is worth about $2 million in this year's budget. So if the override fails, ultimately, that's another $2 million loss on top of the $2 million in state aid. Now, the override, we're going out 1 year early in 2018. The override actually ends in 2019. But we're going out early, that way in case something happens and the override does not pass, we get one more shot at it before it starts hitting its decreases and then ultimately falls off of the books. We can't handle this kind of financial hit. Other information for you is that the state of Arizona, according to all prognostications, is going to be voting again on Prop 301. And they're going to be holding off until the 2019 election cycle to vote on that. It does fall off the books in 2019. So if it does not pass the first time out, every school district in the state of Arizona is in big trouble. Because we rely heavily on those Prop 301 funds in order to help with salaries for our certified staff. The last little piece of tidbit of information, which is just kind of this side, is just remember, though this one kind of in your back pocket, we have increased our budget from 2015-16 to 2016-17 with Pearson Math. And we have a contract with Pearson Math to help our students. It's a good program. I like it, Melanie likes it, the teachers like it, the kids may not like it because it's got a lot of homework with it. But that's not a bad thing. It's a good program for mathematics, but we do have an additional contract that we have to think of that we did not have before, and that's a $200,000 expense that also has to get factored in because it's a brand new contract for our school district this year. Okay? So let's take a look at M&O, which is this side of the house over here.
Shannon, I have a question.
Yeah.
As we talk about the $2 million state aid that comes in and the dollar signs above each student, and I understand we still have to pay the same amount of electricity regardless if there's 100 kids in one classroom or one kid in
correct.
A classroom. So how many dollars of that $2 million is directly impacted? You know, obviously if we have 100 less students, that might be two less buses that run. So what's the impact on having less students financially? As we know, the $2 million state aid is lost because we don't get that whole dollar. But if the student's not here, how much are we?
Very little.
Because it still costs the same amount to heat the building,
right.
To cool the building.
Yeah. And what is some of those items that if the student's not here, how many dollars is it without that student being here? Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does.
We don't have a computer for them, we don't have to do.
It very little.
in regards to the amount of kids that we're talking to, because that cost, you said it exactly correct. It costs a certain amount to run the buildings.
Absolutely right.
And I don't care if you have zero people in it. If you fire up the buildings, it costs.
Right.
And so realistically, by them not being here, it just hurts us, because we still have the expense, but we're not getting the revenue for it. The bus still has to run, and that kid may be absent in this house, but the bus still has to go by the house because he's got to pick up this kid and this kid.
Yeah. So I just didn't know if there was half $2 and some other basically.
And that's a good question. Yeah. It's a great question, but the answer is unfortunately no.
Okay.
All right, so here's where we are as of today. As of today, if we were able to wave our magical flag, I just noticed, we're going to have to work on that. That whole board may come down. I hope not on film. As of today, our carryover, if we ended the school year today, would be $4,381,451.72. That's not what it's going to wind up being. It's probably going to be an estimated at $4 million, since we still got a ways to go before the end of the school year. If something's going to happen, it always does. Okay? So for our purposes of this conversation, we're going to look at a $4 million number, because that's probably what it's going to be closer to by the time we get done with the end of the school year. So, this number also includes insurance. So let's talk about that for a second. Our insurance premiums for our school district were going up significantly. They were going up significantly, as Mary Ann so eloquently explained in a couple of school board meetings ago. Number one, it's going up because insurance is going up. If you haven't noticed that, then you need to go and take a look at your paycheck, because insurance is going up. Okay. Number two is because the usage in our school district has, for the last 2 years, exceeded our premiums. So the insurance company has actually lost money by insuring us, because we've used more than what we have paid in. So the real answer for the insurance company is they're not going to take that loss. They pass that on to you. So originally, we had ballparked and projected about 25% to 30% was what our insurance was going to go up. That was an estimated cost of about $450,000. So we decided that that was not very good for our district. So we asked the board, and thank you very much for allowing us to go out. Let's go bid this stuff. Let's go out to the open market, and let's go try and see what we can get. And we also notified our current insurance folks of what they were doing. And good news is that Marion has done a great job of playing poker out in the open market, and our insurance premiums, in order to maintain the same coverage, which is a phenomenal insurance package, and I think it's one of the best insurance packages in the county for our employees, compared to what other schools are able to offer for insurance, it's only going to go up 13.5%, which is awesome. So that was some nice cost savings for our district. So the increase in regards to insurance premiums was $250,000 for our district. So Gina and Sharon and I have already encumbered that, and we are already prepared to pay that, to get that off of our books in one bulk lump sum, heading into next year. So this number right here, the 4.38145.72, includes the school district taking care of people's insurance, which is phenomenal for our school district based upon this insurance climate that we're in. Many school districts across this state are just going to pass those insurance premiums on to their employees. I just don't think that's fair, especially for an employee who's not getting a pay raise. Their pay may be frozen, and then they get an insurance and they get an increase in insurance premiums, and so it's actually a salary decrease. Or they're able to offer their employees an increase in salary, but they're not able to pay the increase in insurance. So congratulations, your pay raise just went to the insurance company. And that's not a fair way to treat your employees. So this covers the insurance for folks. So that leaves us with the estimated ballpark of $4 million. Okay, so here's your $2 million to maintain everything that we're doing right now. Now, we always take a critical look at master schedules, trying to make sure that everyone's got full loads and looking at all of that. We do that every year, regardless of how much money that we have. But in theoretical purposes, we plug the hole. What that also does is it provides this district an opportunity to have lower class sizes next year. If we can maintain what we've got, but we've got a decreased number of kids, and congratulations, we've just lowered class sizes. which is pretty awesome, which was one of the four goals that was listed up on the board. Okay? The other one is that for our school district, in order to maintain this, we have got to have approximately $1.5 to $2 million in carryover for stability. Our general fund or M&O monthly payroll is about $1.2 million a month. Now, I would much rather have it closer to the $2 million. Ooh, that makes my job a whole lot easier. Anything closer to the 1.5, Gina, Sharon, and I start having a lot of arguments in regards to how we're going to make that work. Okay? So that's a toggle range of what we're looking for. So again, anywhere between $1.5 million to $2 million is what we have to have in order to maintain that financial stability for our district. And then the last one is a step raise for all employees is approximately $450,000. Board members, you now have the superintendent and financial department's recommendation for our budget for next year, and there it sits. Number one, we provide financial stability and security for this school district. Number two, we provide a pay raise for all employees. Number three, we take care of the employee's health insurance because that's what an employer is supposed to do. And number four, with inside the budget capacities and the money that we have, we do everything possible to lower class sizes. I want to stress it again. You now have my recommendation, Gina's recommendation, and Sharon's recommendation in regards to what our budget looks like for next year in regards to M&O. Or general fund, gas bill, water bill, electric bill, payroll. Okay? Next item that we have is the other side of the house, and that is our capital side of the house. Building and maintenance. As of right now, we have about $1.2 million and some change sitting in that account. If you remember, we were saving money in that account for what, Tony?
Buildings,
maintenance, stuff that's got to be fixed around the school district, okay? If you remember, the elementary district went through a similar process, but they found out that they had more repairs than what they could maintain and went out for a bond issue, okay? That was a great thing, I think, for our elementary district. What we're trying to do is we're trying to do that with inside the bounds of our capital funds, okay? So, we have gone out. First of all, we tried to save our money to fix things. So we went out for grant opportunities through the Arizona School Facilities Board to try to see if we could dip into what the state of Arizona has refused to pay for schools all across the state, which is capital. And a matter of fact, I do need to probably tell you, next week there will be another lawsuit filed on behalf of all of the education alphabets. ASA is going to be filing that lawsuit. I'm a member of that group, and in essence we're going to be suing the state for capital because the state has neglected its own laws in regards to how it's supposed to fund capitals for schools. And right now all across the state we have school buildings that are not at code, that are not in compliance, that are not meeting the regulations of ADA, simply because school districts cannot maintain what needs to be done because the state is not meeting their obligation in regards to capital, okay? That lawsuit will probably be filed Monday, Tuesday of next week. What the state has done in an effort to try and offset, in my opinion, their delinquent ability to pay capital is they've created something called the Arizona School Facilities Board, at which they take a pittance of the state budget and put it into this fund, and then they have school districts go and apply for grants to try and get things fixed. And then we apply for grants, and then we lobby, and we wait, and we politic, and we talk, and hopefully we try to get money out of the school facilities board. Now, we have been able to fund some major projects out of the school facilities board, and I will tell you, I'm very, very pleased with what Mr. Mason and I have been able to do with the school's facilities board, because without these funds, board members, we would be in a world of hurt in regards to our facilities. Now, we have gotten more than what's on this list, okay? They have been smaller items. As an example, we got the school facilities board in order to pay for some air conditioning units that were here at this building. for Desert Winds, and then also some backup air conditioners for Dave for the servers, which was great. That was a $50,000 project, but I didn't list it here, not because it wasn't significant, because I don't have a big enough whiteboard. So these are the major projects that we were able to get funded. We have got chillers at Union. That was a $300,000 project. Without the chillers at Union, starting this summer, Union would not have air conditioning, period. Chillers would have died. Okay? So very, very pleased. And the brand new chiller should be completed and installed over spring break. And then they'll run those tests to bring it all online. And a matter of fact, it's a new chiller to take more of the load off of the other chillers in order to help sustain those, because there's three of them over there. Two of them are really bad, and the one big one, we needed to take it outside and kind of shoot it. It was awful. Okay. The other one is the drainage issues that we were kind of getting in trouble for on the back side of the bus barn, of all the water retention and all the things that we're supposed to do according to code in regards to water runoff and water drainage. And if you want to take a look at that project and see all the earth moving dirt and stuff, Chuck, you'd love it. Just go back there behind the bus barn. Drive real slow through the bus barn, though, because those bus drivers will honk at you if you don't. But you're more than welcome to go on the back side and check that out. It's a pretty awesome feat of engineering. I was quite impressed in regards to how they did ponds of sub-ponds and sub-ponds in order to retain and move the water. It's pretty awesome. The other one is this roof. And the district officer at the Desert Winds Learning Center, that's a $300,000 project. It was a $250,000 project, but this roof was so complicated that they had to do a $50,000 engineering job. In regards to making sure that all the specs were done and done appropriately in regards to this roof. The one project that did not get approved, but we are still holding out for and keeping our fingers crossed, is the roof at Vista Grande. It's Glenda's roof, okay? It's bad, and it's 6 years old. It's bad.
And the contractor doesn't have to stand behind that?
The contractor has done its part to meet the minimum requirements of their contract. So I've got some folks who's trying to put some other political pressure on them to get them out here to do stuff, but they have met their obligation. So in regards to, can we go back and sue the contractor? No. They've met the requirements of the law, the minimal requirements of the law. Now I will tell you that Mr. Mace has done a great job, and we've sent the boys up on top of the roof, and they have duct taped it, shellacked it, sealed it, caulked it. They have done everything possible in regards to seal that roof. And the last time that we had the last heavy rains that came through about a month ago, it did not leak.
Then I'm up there again.
However, I am guaranteeing that work for 5 years or 5 minutes, whichever one comes first. Because I cannot guarantee you in regards to if the roof will hold. So out of this $1.2 million, the first thing that we have to do is we have to withhold $500,000 off the top. Because if bad stuff happens to the roof, we're not going to have a choice. Now, we're going to try and hit the school board facilities again next year in regards to the roof. And we're going to keep hitting them. But right now, it is a dice rolling game with that roof in regards to whether we invest the money to go and fix it, whether we can get the school facilities board to fix it, and whether or not the maintenance crew can keep it caulked, shellacked, and duct taped in order to make it work. But that's where we are in regards to facilities at Vista. But the good news is that because we've been able to fund some of these other projects, we now have the opportunity to reserve some funds if we need be. Now, of course, if the school facilities board comes through next year with the $500,000, well, we got $500,000 to go somewhere else in regards to fixing projects. So what that does is that leaves us $700,000 left over starting now in order to start funding some of these projects and getting these projects online so that we can start working on them and completing them over the summer. So coming in April, you're going to start having some recommendations from me in regards to getting some of these projects completed and brought up to where they need to be. So let's go over the list of the bigger ticket items. This isn't the complete list by any means, but these are the bigger ticket items. Okay? So we've got $100,000 for cameras because our camera system is bad. Don't write that. Don't tell the kids. Okay? But realistically, We can't video anybody. Okay? I mean, it's not good. Okay? We've already talked about our backup generator project that's for our servers. Our bathrooms at Union have got to be brought up to code because right now they're not. We're subject to quite a significant lawsuit in regards to our bathrooms. The other thing is that Union, and most of these are at Union because it's just the older campus, okay? It's just seeing a lot of wear and tear and it just needs some TLC. We have got to complete and bring up to code all of the OSHAs, the handicaps, the trip and fall hazards, all of those things that are required for a school district to have because we are not in compliance with that, those rules, laws, and regulations at Union, and quite frankly, neither is most of the state in many of their buildings. Okay? The other one is the parking lot at Union. That's a $750,000 project. The metal fatigue and the metal paint, and if you want to know more about metal fatigue and metal, you can see Chuck after the meeting, and he will give you a diatribe dissertation on metal fatigue and how that works in regards to securing the structure of buildings. Is it critical right now for the metal fatigue? No. Is it going to be? Yeah. When? Uh-oh. Ask Chuck. He can probably give you a better answer. Okay. Also, as well, we need desks. Kids need desks. Teachers need desks. We've got to have some furniture. A lot of the stuff that we have is just old and outdated, and it just needs to be thrown away. And then also, as well, the tennis courts at Union. Right now, the top of the tennis courts is starting to pop off. I know it doesn't freeze very often here in Arizona, but it does every once in a while. And what happens is that water gets in there underneath that top coat, and then when it freezes, just like ice does, it expands, and as it expands, poof, there goes the top coat. And then as it rains, it's just like a pothole. More and more and more and more and more. Right now, this is a $50,000 project. If we wait on this project, it's going to be significant because once tennis courts start to peel, they go pretty quick from one little spot into the whole thing's got to be redone. So this kind of sums up some of the information that we presented at the last meeting. You all were wanting some more finalization in regards to numbers. There they sit. You now have the maintenance and operations or capital fund game plan from myself and from Gina and from Sharon in regards to our direction and focus for the district. Wes?
Yeah, with the school facility board, as we see a list there, are those going to take present? I mean, if let's say the roof get, let me start over again. All those have been submitted to the board for approval.
Approved.
Oh, approved. I'm sorry. Okay, so you're just waiting on one more.
Yeah, and one more big one.
Okay.
We've submitted all of these. All of these have been submitted, and they have been officially rejected.
Okay.
This one, they said, we're not going to approve it right now. Come back and talk to me next year. So that's why it's still on this side, because we're still holding out hope. But all of these have been funded and are either underway, will be underway soon, but they will be completed before the end of this fiscal year.
And I'm sure the board, as I do, appreciate the list and the checklist and evaluating, you know, what needs to get done at each campus, near the school district. But if something was to happen, has this been prioritized as far as the...
This?
Yes.
No. That's part of what we're going to start having meetings on for the district. That's what I'm saying. You're going to start seeing recommendations coming to us from next month because the team's going to get to work. We're going to start having conversations. I've got my priorities. You know, I don't know if my priorities are the same as Tom's or the same as Glenda's or, you know, so, or the same as even Mr. Mace. So we're going to start having those meetings.
And I've always been a proponent of, you know, trying to get, and you've done that, is getting our district financially sound, as whether it's from the capital or from the M&O side. But when we look at capital projects, we know, and I think I know Ed and myself keep pounding this, but is there any way that we can still work with Tim and trying to get this projection as, you know, as far out for 1 year to 5 years to 10 years? And so,
yes.
I love seeing this every year, but you know, if we have to kick the can down the road for something, you know, cannot be a number one for a 3 year out. project. Because then, like you said, Mr. Grandy's going to have their problems. So I mean, again, you identified some, and I'm sure there's a whole bunch.
Oh, there's a big long list. I don't have enough whiteboard space.
Right, exactly.
So the answer to your question is yes, Tim is working on that.
Okay.
And then there's also the maintenance schedules that we have.
Sure.
As an example, the maintenance schedules on the track to reseal them, the maintenance schedules on the gym floors to receive them, because those have to be done every year. And then there are some maintenance projects that I'm trying to get the activity funds to pay for. As an example, the scoreboard at Union. We got a new scoreboard at Union, right? Which was awesome because we went half the season without a scoreboard because it died. And we really didn't know where our finances were, and we couldn't in regards to this capital stuff. And so I told Randy, you know, you're on your own, man. So he did a great job in regards to raising the funds and getting the scoreboard. However, he only bought the board, not the poles. So the new board is mounted on the old poles, which according to code and according to the manufacturer of the scoreboard will not hold the weight of the scoreboard. So this summer, we have got to drive poles that go down, I don't know, 10 some odd feet into the ground full of concrete in order to remount the scoreboard, because the poles will go in front of, towards the end zone or towards the home stands. The new poles will go in front of there, and we're trying to fund that out of the activity athletic account, so that way that project does not appear here, because each one of those poles is about $10,000. So that's a $30,000 project just in the poles that we need to go mount the brand new scoreboard that Randy just bought. And so one of the things that he's trying to do is to offset that cost with advertising on the scoreboard, so that we can get some of those upfront costs paid for and continue to do that. But those are things that we're trying to do through the activity funds, not through the general fund, or not through the capital fund, excuse me. But if we can't, then some of those projects may wind up back on this list, because that project has to be done, and it has to be done this summer, because if we get the big windstorms that come through in the fall, that scoreboard that we just bought is gone, because those poles won't hold it up. Any other thoughts, theories, and ideas?
Just food for thought that OSHA and safety don't need to be the top priority. I mean, so safety.
Okay, here we go. You ready?
There you go. I just want
to. One.
Yeah, that's a cameras, chip zones.
Four. I think. Five.
Yeah, they're all on his.
Yeah. Well, when you say OSHA, that could usually end up costing more money if you
get
cut.
So, out of the 70,000, just my opinion, there's your top five. But I need to take that to committee to let other people talk about it. But that's just your top five. Now, of course, that does not really leave us with enough money to start addressing these. But maybe if I can get the bathrooms under $100,000, then that's more money that I can shift into this number to maybe start taking a look at some of that other stuff. And I don't know, Chuck, can you paint half a beam? Can you do that? Look kind of odd with one half of the building painted, the other half not painted. I don't know. But those are...
Well, and Trump Care is going to drive down the insurance premium.
This is going to be zero. That will be zero. That'll be zero. I'm going to take that to the and spend it somewhere else. But again, you now have the recommendation of me, and you now have the recommendation of the finance department, so I'm going to go over those one more time. The first one is that our school district covers the $2 million haul with our $4 million carryover. We provide $1.5 to upwards of $2 million for the financial stability of carryover heading into our funding, heading into this year, okay? Heading into this year. Then that also as well provides us the opportunity to give every single staff member in the school district a pay raise because they deserve it, and the school's covered insurance. And we have met all of our financial goals for our district. And then on the capital funds, is that you see it, is that we start spending the $700,000 because we have got to start addressing some of these issues in our facilities needs, but we're going to hold out $500,000 for that in case, because I don't know what else to do with it.
Don't know if you said it or not, Shannon, but are you able to carry over any capital funds?
Yes.
Oh, but I mean, is there a maximum or a minimum?
None of those. provisions, all of those laws in regards to carryovers are gone.
So there's no soft capital, there's none. So you can carry as much as you want over in capital.
Yes, and the reasons why they did that is because realistically there are those at the Capitol who do not want school districts to go out for bond issues. They would prefer, which is a good financial plan, for school districts to save their money. I mean, if you've got this kind of a problem, then save your money, plan for that accordingly, get on a PM schedule, just like you said, plan and prepare so that you can spend the money accordingly, carry money over accordingly in order to offset these costs, and maybe you won't have to go out for a bond issue. But if you put limits on that, like you can only carry over 2%, well, there's no way. There's no way I can plan or save for anything. So I really like the idea that they took off of those limits because it provides us the opportunities that we can, I don't know, kind of manage our own destiny in regards to the facilities and maintenance and how we're going to financially run the district. But before, we were always worried about, are we at the mark or below the mark? It's kind of that same concept for the Navy. You know, you got to paint that ship 5 times in order to get it within budget. All that stuff is gone, which I think is a better way to run a school district.
And then, because, and I don't know if I'm using the right term, but self-insured, but, you know, when we had the incident at the Cougar State auditorium where we had constant leaks and tore up the floor and everything else, we got that fixed. If we spend all this money, how are we going to cover our own emergency expenses?
Well, we will also get capital money again next year.
Right up front.
Uh-huh.
We get a lump sum up front.
Well, it comes in waves, but we get a budget in regard to what capital is. So it provides us once again to start taking a look at what are our expenses, what's coming up, what needs to be fixed, and now we're back at this list again.
Okay, so you don't hold on to $1.52 million in capital, even though we don't have to.
So is the $1.2 million in capital list up there a carryover, or
that's what we got? It. That's what
we still have left.
That's what we still have left. Because if you remember, I told you in July that we were saving our monies for this purpose. We were saving our money last year in order to get to this number. Now, of course, out of the capital, you got to start allocating money out for field maintenance. You got to start blah blah blah. I mean, the list goes on and on and on and on and on in regards to Mr. Mace's budget. But we've been preparing for this contingency. I realize that some of these numbers may be new to you, but Gina and Sharon and I have been working on this stuff for over a year and a half.
The 100,000 on cameras, I thought our override was towards security and those types of costs.
It is, but the budget override doesn't cover everything. We use budget override funds for extracurricular activities. We use budget override funds to help with electives. We also use budget override funds to help with security. However, the $2 million that we get on the override doesn't cover everything. I mean, it helps, but it's not going to cover all of it.
The
yeah.
Override is just M&O. This is a capital expense here.
Okay.
So the override wouldn't.
Anything else? We've got crew that's showing up.
One more thing, the step raise for all employees, that's in addition to any 301 money that would come available for certified employees, right?
Mm-hmm. You're talking about the incentive funds?
Well, the incentive and the part that goes on to the salary schedule.
The part that goes on to the salary schedule is included in regards to this. Now, the incentive money is the incentive money of whatever that winds up being. That's all based upon tax dollars, as you know, so it's a random variable. So once the salary schedule scale is satisfied, then what is left over is, I call it the hoops jumping money, because you got to jump through hoops to get it. Some people call it the incentive money, whichever one you want to call it. But yeah, then that extra that's left over in that at the end of the year or at the end of those cycles, that's the incentive part.
But the part that goes towards the salary, the 01, the 11 and the 13, those will still go in if there's additional money into the salary schedule.
I don't necessarily follow your question. There are two components, in theory, to 301. There is dollars that go into the general fund scale, the salary schedule scale, and then there are dollars that are incentive. This incorporates and includes the things that go into the general fund. Into the salary schedule scale. I do not count or facilitate or manage the incentive money. So if there are dollars that are left over, once the salary schedule scale is satisfied with all funds, whether that be M&O funds, 301 funds, etc., then what's left over goes to those folks that has completed the 301 plans.
Well, like this year, they got $1,500. Of the $2,000 raise, $1,500 was from 301 funds.
Yes.
So the district only gave $500. What I'm
not necessarily. I think that's a little bit off.
$532. But if they do get additional funding through 301, if it goes up again this year, that will be in addition to the step.
But I can't calculate that because
if it does go up.
Now you also have to remember is that out of that 301 that you're talking about, yes, some of it went into the salary schedule scale. Okay, some of it came from the district, but then the district also gave every employee a step on top of that. So that equated to about $1,500. So the whole theoretical purpose of that was about $1,500 of it came from the 301 funds, and then $1,500 of it came from the district for an increase of approximately, for folks, $3,000 on the general fund salary schedule scale, which was pretty awesome. There's no school district in the state that did that.
But, I guess because I'm not clear on it, but the 301 money, it's my understanding they were going to get anyway, correct? So the other employees outside of the teachers, they got the full step and part of the 301
all
money.
All employees got a step.
Okay, but then the teachers, their 301 was part of their step. And they were going to get that.
500 anyway. Of it. No, 1,500 of
it.
Mary, help me out.
The 301 funds on the salary schedule are completely separate than that. That comes from a whole different fund. So the 301 on the salary schedule, on the certified salary schedule, is not included in that. That is a whole different deal.
So I guess
And the teachers, everybody got a step last year, and the teachers got an additional 500 out of M&O on the salary schedule. The 1,500 came out of the 301 fund.
So the 301 will satisfy what the 301 is supposed to satisfy, and the district will satisfy what the district is supposed to.
Because of the new salary schedule that was voted in, they're using a higher proportion of the 301 money to satisfy the change or the different salary schedule. And then like Shannon said, whatever's left over from the increase of the 301 money that's used in that will then go over into the teachers.
For the incentive part.
But so
in order to get an incentive, you got to do a 301 plan and meet all the requirements. And all
in order to get a pay raise on the salary schedule, you got to get the 301.
Okay. We've got a lot of folks that are showing up for a meeting that starts in 4 minutes. You